All right.
Good. All right. I think we're going to get started, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. A room full of budding Carnegie Mellon entrepreneurs. I hope some of you had the opportunity to pitch to Max and his team. He told me the real story after you guys left, so I can give you the feedback later. obviously, we're very fortunate to have such a great entrepreneur, Max Levchin, here today. Before I introduce him formally, I'd like to thank Catherine Capitas from the Carnegie Mellon Computer Science Department for putting this all together. So if you all can give her a quick hand, thank you. She's working so hard, she's out in the hallway, so she didn't even get to hear her kudos. Max is an amazing guy. I could leave it right there, you all know the history, but Max is the CEO of a firm, the next generation financial services company offering consumer credit at the point of sale. And he's also the chairman of GLOW, which is a woman health and fertility company. And both of these companies were created and launched from his San Francisco-based innovation and investment lab, HVF, which we'll talk about a little bit later. Max is going to be even more famous because of these great companies that he's running, but many of you know him as one of the original founders of PayPal, where he served as the CTO until the company was acquired by eBay back in 2002. In 2004, many of you might not know this, he was actually helped to found Yelp, and he still, to this day, serves as the chairman of Yelp. Concurrently that year, he started a company called Slide, which is a personal media sharing service for social networking sites, where he was the CEO until Google purchased it in 2010. He also serves on the board of Yahoo, Yelp, and Evernote, and he's an active early stage investor, which many of you already know. All I gotta say is I feel like I'm here with the Tony Soprano of geekdom, right? The PayPal mafia, and
I am the nerd.
Yeah. Just don't kill me, right? Obviously, PayPal, Slide, Yelp, these were incredibly disruptive companies, right? What traits, what skills, what habits did you bring to the table in each of those that helped make you successful?
I'm not sure there's a single answer that describes it all. I think everybody takes a different cut at what it means to be an entrepreneur, sort of what makes them who they are as an entrepreneur, successful or not. My guess is that my legacy will probably be the hardest working nerd or something like that. My general approach to solving problems has always been, don't say no, there's got to be a way. Just think harder, work more hours, and work smarter too. So I'm not entirely all about brute force solutions, but ultimately most of those companies, in my view, were successful because people just were not willing to take a no for an answer. And that's an approach that works pretty well for a lot of people, I think. So that's a good trait. One could call it grit or drive or, you know, whatever the favorite one line or one word to describe it, but ultimately it's just sort of the never surrender attitude that gets you places.
I always said, you know, people can be a lot smarter than me, but they can't outwork me, right? It's the same, yeah. So tell us an example at PayPal where you brought that sure, you know, will, force of will to wrestle something to the ground.
The classic story that's actually, this is a great CMU relevant story. This comes up as a thorny subject every once in a while, so it's worth putting to rest. So if you search for CAPTCHA, you'll find two entirely separate places credited with its invention. A professor and a graduate student at CMU, and yours truly. The truth is that I'm confident, well, CAPTCHA was named here, so the name CAPTCHA is certainly a trademark that belongs to CMU, if I remember correctly. So it was definitely invented here, and at the time, completely unbeknownst to us, because we would have used it in a heartbeat had we known it existed, we invented it too at PayPal. And so the reason we had to come up with it was just like the purpose of original CAPTCHA invention here, which was designed to keep out bots from chat rooms. We had a much more serious problem. We had 20 to 25,000 daily automated signups for PayPal. So bad guys would write scripts and would sign up automatically and just create thousands of accounts, and then they would automatically populate those accounts with stolen credit cards, and then would use automated scripts to move money from those stolen credit cards from account to account to account so many times that at some point it became impossible to track where the money really went, and then they would gather it all up in one master account and withdraw it. And then 48 hours later, people would notice that the money had been stolen, they would just start charging the cards back, be a huge fraud loss associated with it because PayPal would be on the hook for it. And then we would finally track down the master account that was used for withdrawal, but it would be too late. The money had left the system and we'd be left holding the bag. So one of the solutions that needed to happen as soon as possible, and we were losing money something like $4 to $5 million a week. So this is money, you know, we literally had 6 or 7 weeks to live after having raised a $100 million round just very recently at the time. So it seemed like this crazy impossibility and sort of beating our head against the wall nonstop, kind of asking, what do we do? To add insult to injury, there was this guy, and I know it was a guy because one day he got so cocky, he emailed me because he had been writing most of these scripts. In fact, he became so famous in the sort of a hacker or black hat community that his nickname was The Script. And so he would script out all these different operations against PayPal, like creation of accounts, automated transfer of money. He was just a bad guy. Like, he really was a bad guy. And he emailed me one day because he knew that I could read Russian. So he emailed me in Russian and said, you know, you think you will change your site. So we would change our site. We would make the field names in HTML forms randomized. We would change the placement of buttons. We'd try to figure out how he was automating this stuff. And he finally decided that he could beat us any way he wanted to. And so he sent me an email in Russian saying, you think you can change your site, but I will always figure it out. You think you are a rich American kid that made it, you got your company, and I'm gonna clean you out. You lived in a high rise and I never had a bicycle. I remember this email really well. Yeah, it was like a real call. I mean, the one line about I never had a bicycle, I was like, what does that have to do with bicycles? I never had a bicycle either. But it's actually not true, I had a bicycle. Somebody stole it though. Anyway, so it became like a personal vendetta. And for another 2 or 3 weeks, I was really motivated to, so I would sit, brainstorm with my engineers and be like, all right guys, so what if we made the pages reload random number of times? What if we would redirect to a URL he couldn't figure out? And he clearly built a full browser emulator because he would just play the whole thing out and then automate the sign up. And one day when he wanted to make a point, he made 100,000 accounts in one day, just to make a point. Like, he didn't really need them, and he only had 20,000 stolen credit cards to go for that day. But it became a sort of a existential threat to PayPal, but also a personal struggle for me. So finally one day I just lost it, and I walked out, so I had a cubicle in a far corner of our giant flat office on right next to the garbage dump site in East Palo Alto. I walked out, and the reason I know this is because the smell was always a little questionable. So I walked out and I basically yelled at the engineering team and said, there's got to be a way to figure out when a computer is signing up for PayPal versus a human. What is the task that humans are great at and computers just suck? And this guy named Dave Gausbeck, without looking up from his keyboard, said OCR. Like, oh my God, obstacle character recognition. It is the task. These days, OCR is actually really, really advanced. This is late 90s, early 2000. OCR was still very questionable. And so I had this brain explosion where I ran to my car, jumped in it, drove to Fry's Electronics, which is still around, bizarrely. Best Buy is going out of business. Fry's is still around. And I bought every OCR package that was on the shelf at Fry's and drove back to PayPal and figured out every font that would not get through the OCR system in any one of these packages. And it turned out to be the stencil font, which is the, if you've ever seen Army stenciled on the side of like a, I don't know, what in the movies looks like the way they store RPGs or something like that, typically has these kind of a very stylized stenciled font. So that was the font. And I basically spent the next 48 hours coding up essentially what turned out to be identical to CAPTCHA, having no idea of the research done at CMU. And this, in about a second, this will get unprintable, so I will bleep myself. But so this was literally this Herculean 48-hour, no sleep, started Friday night, And I went full weekend, not taking a single break, just coding like a madman. And on Monday morning, I finally had what essentially was this thing that I threw in front of a bunch of people that were still in the office for whatever strange reason on the weekend. And they could not write a piece of code to break through this very quickly. Finally, I was so confident, I had these two speakers. I was really getting delivery. So 48 hours, I was no sleep at all. So I had these two speakers on stands that for some reason I had in my cubicle that I'd never used. And I figured out a way to balance them on my cubicle wall. And the speakers were facing into the main entrance into the building. And I was blaring Flight of the Valkyries, which is the theme from, it's a famous piece of classical music, but it appears in Apocalypse Now as sort of the precursor to oncoming doom. And I was just blaring as loudly as I could because I decided this guy will either take me down because he'll find something, or this will be my victory. And nothing happened for like 12 hours because I was waiting for him to start his script to make more automated signups. And it didn't happen. Like, well, maybe it's a day off. Like, I was looking like, what time is it in Russia? Is he awake yet? Come on, hit me. And finally, I got another email from him that just said, bleep you. There was never another automated sign-up problem with PayPal.
That's amazing.
Of course, the deflating moment, I was like, I invented something amazing. And 5 weeks later, I finally started looking around, and anybody else has anything like this? I'm like, oh, CMU has one of those things too. I'm like, okay, well, it worked for us, but I should have used their library.
So you know, PayPal's this amazing place. You know, there's Max and Peter and Elon and Reed and, you know, Chad Hurley. You just go down the line, all these people there. Had to be amazing. Slide, how was Slide different? Did you build a team like you had at PayPal?
So I did. The team at Slide was really amazing. One of the interesting measures of success of a company is the things and projects that happen to the team after the company's done. PayPal is certainly very successful, about to become a publicly traded company again, which will be really interesting. I'm very much pro that. But you know that was a great team unequivocally because so many great things came out, YouTube and Yelp and indirectly Facebook and Palantir and all these great companies who were all started or funded by the PayPal alumni. Similarly true for Slide. So Slide to me for a long time was kind of an embarrassment. So my goal number one with Slide was to build something that trumped PayPal success. I really wanted to establish myself as my sophomore act was going to trump my freshman act. And retrospectively, it's very obviously a dumb idea because defining yourself in terms of something that's pretty much set in stone, you're setting yourself up for a failure. Like if you miss it by a dollar or miss it by one user and you're a failure. So that was a mistake, and I've thought long and hard about it, and I figured out a way to judge my projects independent of the past ones. But the thing that I would not compromise on in any startup was the team. And I really wanted to build a fresh group of people that was not yet jaded. One of the things that happened to us when we walked out of PayPal, we were all really jaded. We were basically, never again will we touch financial services industry. It's so hard. It's such a pain. It's just, I will never start another payments company. I literally called Peter after he left a little bit earlier than I did, but we had a phone conversation the day I left, and he said, well, what'd you learn? Like, what did you learn? He said, well, I learned that it's exhausting to be a CEO. I said, well, I'm kind of ready to be a CEO, but I learned that I'm never going to do another financial services company. Of course, it's a disruption of a financial. It takes about a decade to get over the pain. No.
You know, the grass is greener and the shirts are greener.
Yes. But so Slide, I was building this company, and it was very clear that social media was going to be huge, and there'll be money and users and interesting things to do in social media. And in the end, it didn't really play out to be nearly as big as PayPal and ultimately acquired by Google for a ton of money, but not really leveraged beyond the team and some of the really basic technologies. I think in a big way because ultimately in my heart of hearts, I'm not a social animal. I don't really meet that many people easily. I'm kind of introverted. I'm a classic nerd. So building a social product was very hard. And ultimately, I just never quite had the passion for it. The thing that I did succeed with, I built an amazing team. So if you look at the sort of the hot startups of today, the ones that are coming up towards their billion-dollar valuations, a lot of them have the fingerprints of the slide mafia. And it's not quite yet as apparent because these things haven't gone public, but HomeJoy, which is disrupting the sort of the Uber for cleaning ladies and the home services at this point, is run by a product manager from Slide. Mixpanel, which hopefully a bunch of you use to do metrics and analytics on your websites, is run by a guy who ran my product analytics team at Slide. Glow, the fertility company you mentioned, is run by a guy who ran the product team at Slide. So there's a whole bunch of these really top flight people that got their schooling at the guy who runs all engineering for YouTube within Google is my ex-CTO at Slide. So there's a whole bunch of people that have kind of a big footprint, big impact on the industry today. And the team was mostly brand new. These are all really, really young people. They're all in their early 20s when I recruited them. And that really, in the final analysis, Slide appears to have been much more of a success today than when we sold it. I was sort of like, you know, I settled down. I could have gone for broke, but I didn't really have the passion. But I'm very happy that we had a nice exit for a bunch of people because it gave them the confidence to go after something bigger.
Yeah. We kind of look at companies like Hewlett-Packard or Intel as the roots of the family trees of companies. And here we have one called TransArc, which is an amazing company that came out of here in the late 80s that has dotted the landscape. But I think you know, PayPal and Slide will be the roots of the millennial tree that goes out there.
Hope so.
But interestingly, you know, the longest company you've been with is Yelp. And it's a very different entrepreneurial experience because you were never the operator, you were the board member. Tell us how that was different for you.
So it actually resonates really well with what I'm sort of doing now. So I'll take a detour, but I'll get back to Yelp, or remind me if I don't, since I tend to give longer answers than probably should. So after PayPal, I was kind of trying to figure out what I want to be next. So I told Peter I'm ready to be a CEO, and I was very sure that I wanted to run my own show. I really want to be the guy in charge. And I really enjoyed the operational aspects. The operating a company is all about making tough calls and hiring and firing and just being at the controls. And so I really liked that. But I was also just torn apart with 1,000 ideas coming through my head, going like, oh, I really want to do this. And I want to learn how to make video games. And I wanted to try my hand at healthcare. And so I was like, well, I really want to brainstorm. So I set up this lab, which Peter named for me. I had a brilliant name for it, I thought, Midtown Doornail, which is, so it's a cool name for the following reason. I like puzzles and anagrams and stuff like that. Midtown Doornail is the only two-word anagram for world domination. So it's a sort of a, you know, you got to be one step ahead to figure out what that really is.
I'm not playing new Scrabble, no way.
I'm not a native speaker. I learned English, second language, so I have a handicap. But I try harder as a result. But anyway, I think it's a great anagram because it just sounds like a old, you know, something that you have a, I don't know, a bar sign hanging off in the middle of a college town, but it turns out to be this ominous world-dominating implication. So I was going to name that, and I told Peter, and said, that's a terrible name. Like, if you're building a lab, like, you want to be, you know, research science-y, you know, no one needs to know what's going on. It's very mysterious. How about call it MRL Ventures? Why MRL? Well, MRL, your initials, right? But yeah, what's mysterious about that? I said, oh, come on, you should name it that. And it stuck somehow. Midtown Doornail was a much cooler name, and I had the domain, and yet MRL Ventures stuck around. But so we built MRL Ventures, and in it, the format was really simple. It was kind of this round table, Charlie Rose style. A bunch of my smarty pants friends would come together, and some people would come in, some people would come out, and sort of rotated, and some people would stick around for a couple of years, and some would come in for a couple of brainstorm sessions. But basically, we had a single theme, and the theme was the notion of social web was coming about. It was clear that something was going to. MySpace was already a thing. Friendster had just failed. Facebook was beginning. So the idea of people participating online as opposed to just observing was really of the moment. And I sort of asked the question, well, what do societies do outside of the obvious, which is talk to each other? I said, well, human is to sin. So we should explore every deadly sin. And so I had one of my designer friends mock up a giant poster that said, you know, greed, lust, etc. Seven deadly sins, one startup for each. That was the That was the motivation behind MRL.
What's your porn site?
We did not have one for lust, I think. But we pretty much got everyone. We brainstormed what eventually is now, right now the food delivery startup scene is extremely hot. That's like the thing to fund if you're a venture capitalist. And we definitely had the sort of a sketch on the whiteboard of what it means to have a pizza delivered by helicopter. So, and eventually a drone. But anyway, so we didn't really do that. But we did look a lot into vanity, because much of what drives social media is vanity. It's some version of dopamine that happens when you get recognition, when you are friended or followed or responded to. So it was a very serious pursuit with a very silly veneer. Some of the smartest people that joined me during that incubation time or brainstorming time were these two guys, Jeremy Stoppelman and Russ Simmons. Interestingly enough, both of them were my schoolmates at the University of Illinois, where I went to undergrad. And both were, one was chief, initially sort of chief scientist and eventually chief architecture officer, and the other one was head of engineering. So Jeremy was head of engineering, Russ was chief architect at PayPal, basically for all 4 years of the independent existence. So I knew those guys extremely well. I knew they were extremely technically competent, they were really, really smart, and I basically said, look, just come hang out, and if you ever want to start a company, either one of you, I will be right there behind it, no matter what it is you want to do. Spend the entire summer of my, so I turn 40 this coming summer, the summer of my 29th birthday, so Yelp just marked its 10th year anniversary, and the birth date of Yelp is my birthday, because we were, this is very easy to remember since it matches, so on the, it was not exactly on my birthday actually, it was on the day that we had the birthday lunch. So we walked from our office to the Ferry Building in San Francisco and had lunch at this place called Los Lantador, which is still there. It's a great, it's kind of a modern fusion Vietnamese restaurant. And Russ and Jeremy were sitting in the very back of the table and they were just visibly growing very excited about something. And it was clearly not my birthday that they were excited about. And so at the end of this, they're sort of coming to, you know, we've been spending the entire summer brainstorming about Yellow Pages, because the idea of social interaction around business is not new. It's what Yellow Pages does, but it's a terrible model. It's the door-to-door business sales, and it's like a giant super fat magazine that only has ads in it, except that it's all the same type and same format. It's gonna get disrupted, and it's been translated online, but it looks identical to the paper version. Surely somebody's gonna do better. So Jeremy was really interested into this, and during that lunch, Russ and Jeremy came up with the idea of, what if you asked your friends to come, you know, help you annotate the Yellow Pages, which was the original version of Yelp. And so on the walk from the Ferry Building to our office on Mission Street, they sort of sketched out the idea, and by the time we got to the office, I said, all right, fine, I'll write you $1 million check. And I think they didn't expect me to react that way, because they're sort of like, all right, I guess we'll get going on it then. And that's the birth story of Yelp.
So Yellow, Yelp.
Yeah, totally. It was very special.
So MRL Ventures, does that become HVF?
So after Slide, I left Google, which acquired Slide, and I basically said, well, I'm definitely going to run another company, and this time around, I'm going to be extremely passionate about the industry. I'm not going to settle for social is cool. I'm kind of antisocial, but by God, I'm going to do it anyway. I'm going to do something I really care about. The one thing I'm not going to do is financial services. And but to get there, I'm going to... The one thing that I loved MRL and I loved brainstorming, and I certainly enjoyed my time helping founders of Yelp get it off the ground. I take very, very little credit for their success, but I was certainly there from day one through the IPO party and until now. One of my proudest, not possessions, but so I've, over the years I've had one or two awards, most of which are cool, but they don't last. The number one named thing that I love is that in the original office, Yelp's secret kegerator enhanced conference room was titled Levchin's. So I have a conference room named after
five
me.
Stars.
Actually, if you can find it on Yelp, if you look hard enough, you'll actually find, it's a special test record. If you search Yelp in just the right way, you'll find hundreds of test reviews that the engineers put up, and some of them are hilarious. It's like the bartender has a heavy hand, but the attendees are terrible. It's really funny. And over the years, I would come in and like, I should add my own review. Like, no, that would be kind of ridiculous. Like, no, I should add my own review because it's so cool. Anyway, so that is probably my weirdly proudest award ever, having a conference room bar named after me. But HVF is the reenactment of MRL. It's the MRL Act 2. This time the theme is around data. So I've always been really passionate about data. Another sort of a crazy story from my college career is that I was starting my very first company, and this is in the early 90s, so the web is not what it is today. You couldn't just search for information, and I was trying to figure out how to store data in a way that was not just writing it to the end of a text file. And I was talking to my co-founder, and he said, look, I've seen this thing, it's called SQL, but I don't know what it means, but it's kind of neat sounding, you should look into it. And I found the standard, and I read the relational data model, and I had this explosion in my head. I was like, holy crap, I'm gonna spend my entire life using this. This is the most amazing thing I've ever seen. And retrospectively, there's lots of really amazing stuff in computer science, from robotic vision to AI to computer graphics, but somehow the notion of reams and reams of data stored in these relational databases or tables was just mind-blowingly exciting to me. And I've never quite shaken off that excitement. I love the notion of data as the enabler to knowledge. And the translation of data to information, to knowledge, to decisions is really fascinating. So one of the themes of I want to build an incubator or a lab where I'm truly passionate about every project necessitated this unearthing of what was the most exciting learning as a young adult, and it was data. Data really is awesome to me. And so HVF is all about mining data for value.
So tell them what the acronym stands for.
So HVF is a hard, valuable fund. Those are the three necessary and sufficient conditions for me to start a company. And seeing how it's my lab, I can put whatever conditions I want, and I'm fortunate enough to name it after that. I spent a lot of time figuring out what it takes, and so I decided that for me, it's got to be as difficult as it is valuable, and it has to be pretty fun.
They're not leaving because they don't like you. There's a 6:30 class time.
I never take offense. People leave. I try to revise my material.
So what's emerging from HVF? What are the cool things coming out of there?
So Affirm, the consumer bank of the future, is coming out.
Ooh,
that's the first.
You're not doing financial services ever again.
Right. So I swore it off, and my co-founder, Jeff, which is hopefully somewhere around here interviewing potential interns and more for Affirm, who's a CMU grad, was the first lab. I think we call it Leb Share now, but he was just hanging out because he was tired of his job, and I knew him very randomly through a road cycling scene. I'm an avid road cyclist in my copious spare time, so I was riding and met this guy, and he was a really good athlete, and I was kind of like, why does he keep on asking about startups? And then I realized it actually was a rare connection between a jock and a computer scientist with a good degree from CMU and a startup guy. I'm like, well, might as well befriend this guy. So the outcome of that friendship became that he would hang out with me, and we brainstormed about data, and kind of ultimately drifted into this notion, well, data as underwriting criteria for credit. And I really spent a lot of time trying to convince him and myself that I'm never going to touch another payments product, another banking product, another credit product. I'm just done with all that stuff. And of course, within a half a year, we started a company. And then, of course, everyone I knew in the post-PayPal ecosystem, I asked them, hey, I'm going to build another payments company, another credit company, but I'm not going to run it. This guy, Jeff, is going to run it. It's going to be amazing. We're going to find a big team. Do you want to join it? And pretty much the same story played out over and over again. They'd say, oh, you're going to do another payments company? Of course I'm going to. No, I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to help it. Like I helped Yelp. Like, oh, if you're not going to do it, well, if you're the payments guy and you're not going to do this one, so it's not really a payments company. It's a credit company. That's pretty similar. Like, if you're going to do it, we want to do it. But if you're not going to be really throwing your weight behind it, maybe you're not as excited. And so I spent a bunch of time trying to convince myself that I wasn't really excited about it. And finally I said, this is a great idea. It's going to be awesome. Why shouldn't I run it? So it was my plan was to spin out 10 companies and then run the 10th one. And of course, I spun out one and I started by running it. It didn't stop me from having more ideas though. So Glow spun out next year, and we're probably gonna spin out one more in the next 12 months. And the pace of spin out that we have from HVF is about one a year, which is
So give us a little bit more detail on a firm. It's 2 years in, you have a buy with a firm product.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a firm is basically point of sale financing today, trying to expand into basically being the bank of the future. So point of sale financing is really simple to understand. When you go to Macy's, they try to convince you to open a store card. So, you know, save 10%, get a credit card. That's a terrible deal. You should never do it. Hopefully you understand that it's designed to screw you. It really is. It's going to give you a credit card that has a low limit, high rate, and the 6 months same as cash introductory APR financing is actually a way for you to not think about their product for 6 months, so that on 6 months in one day, when you miss the first payment and say, aha, that same as cash, that compounded. Now you are due full 13, 15% of the half, from the half a year of the principal. Don't do it. In fact, most people your age and sort of basically all the ages between mine and yours, which is roughly 15 year difference, are pretty aware of this. But a lot of, and a lot of them don't really like their credit card to begin with. They just understand that it's really designed, revolving credit accounts are designed to benefit from people's irresponsibility. It's all about, hey, if we catch you late, we'll charge you. If we can figure out a way to throw in a hidden fee, we will do that, because those are 100% margin products. Just lending money, who wants to do that? So we said, well, what if we reverse the whole thing? What if we built an honest, transparent version of the same thing? So we will not give you a card. We will not charge you late fees. We will not charge you hidden fees. We'll actually make the whole thing entirely upside down. Transparent, determined a priori, installment payments that are spelled out at the time of the purchase. Basically something that allows you to take anything you want to buy, split it into multiple payments, and just pay it off across several months without opening a credit account, which is how things used to be. You'd be able to go to a store and say, hey, I can't really afford this thing, but I need it. Can I just pay it off over the course of 3 months? And the shopkeeper would say, sure, you know, time's money, so I'll charge you 10 bucks extra for that. Is that okay? You'll say, yeah, of course, I can totally afford extra dollar or extra $3 every 3 months for the right to have this thing now. And that's how credit came to be. So somewhere along the way, we've drifted into this notion of you need a card and you need hidden fees and sort of these evil charges. So we basically decided to go back to the original model. We launched that, and about 100 merchants have now adopted it. And it seems to do wonders for the millennial demographic, because the digitally aware people are no longer fooled by the sort of, oh, you know, don't look over here, the back of the bill has a floating rate, but you don't need to understand what it means. They're pretty savvy. They say that they understand that if it's small print, it's probably designed to screw you. So they look for well-designed systems that are transparent and say, here's what it costs. So that's been growing really well, actually. We spent a long time trying to convince merchants to give it a try. Once they have gotten a hold of it and they got it launched, they realized that young people, especially students or people who just started a family that have these purchases that put strain on their cash flow, really benefit from this. Their sales increased as a result. So we've been seeing a lot of adoption and a lot of kind of obvious purchases like furniture and larger appliances. Bicycles are very popular because that's a sort of commuter good.
How do you use big data to optimize how a firm works?
So it all sounds really nice, but part of the reason why people create these surcharges is because lending is not, which is what we do, is not a lossless industry. Among people who want to borrow money, there's always one or two that say, I want to borrow, but I have no intention of paying back. And within the group that says, I do have all the intention of paying back, some are actually just irresponsible. They think they can, but they cannot. They have an absolutely misconceived notion of how much money they have access to and what their cash flow will look like. Or there's kind of say, you know what, I'm going to definitely get a job next month. But something happens and they don't. The third group, which is actually a small but the most difficult one to help, is the sort of bad things happen to good people. Somebody gets hit by a car, they now have medical bills to take care of, they can't pay off their bills, and they just can't. There's nothing wrong with them socially, they're not trying to steal money, they cannot afford it right now, and it's changed between the time you lent them money and now. And so big data allows us to actually build models that predict very precisely, I might add, back to my sort of CAPTCHA and the PayPal version of its story, fraud, the first group, is very easy to catch. It takes a lot of effort, but it's a really fun mathematical problem where you gather behavioral data, anything from how quickly they type their name to what their browser clock says to what the real clock really says about. There's just all kinds of really interesting data you can capture about their interaction with the, with our products. And say, what is the probability this person is not who they say they are? Because if they're not using their own identity, chances are they have no intention of paying it off for the other guy that they're pretending to be. So that's sort of one side of big data. The other side that's a lot more, not common, but that's what the traditional banking industry already uses data for, although they don't really use big data, they just use a couple of variables and call it a model, is underwriting, where they say, given your income, given your debt, given information about you in the credit bureau databases, can we forecast how likely you are to actually be a responsible citizen? Mm-hmm. No one really has figured out at all how to predict the future enough to say bad things happen to good people, and so we can sort of peek into your future and say you really shouldn't be borrowing money. At best, we can predict over a large population how many people roughly will a bad thing happen to. We're actually trying to make a dent even in that problem too. That will require a lot, but I think that is closer to things like health insurance, where we're trying to figure out how someone's lifestyle, as much of it as they're willing to share with us, impacts their ability or their likelihood of unexpected bad things. The reason they would want to share it with us, this is obviously a data privacy issue, you know, do you really want to tell me you're an avid snowboarder and you might break a leg and therefore your rate should be higher than the one, you know, a sedentary lifestyle person, or maybe even maybe somebody who is active but not quite as dangerously active. Reason for it is you can think of it as a negative thing. You penalize someone who is a high risk. You can also flip it around and say somebody who is a likely exemplary low-risk citizen should enjoy extremely low rates, because not only do we know that they're not fraudulent and they have all the intention and responsibility of paying it back, they're extremely unlikely to default. And if so, we should be able to give them essentially a free loan or something that's very, very close to a free loan. So that's, I mean, that one is very futuristic. The middle one is underwriting better than FICO score, which is what's used today by the banking industry. The first one is fraud, and I am one of these weird people that delights in pursuit of chasing bad guys.
So the big data is behind everything coming out of HVF, right? Yeah. So the first one is I'm never going to do another payments company. I do a payments company. The next one is women fertility. Tell us about how you apply big data to that problem.
So GLOW, hopefully, you're the exact target demo. Certainly the female half of the audience, although unfortunately female, not really a half. Well, it's good to see women in tech. You are the core demo, although I figured out that you were the core demo a little bit later into the game. So when we started, I had this thought, well, we're doing a bunch of interesting data things for finance, but we're not really using data for healthcare, which is ridiculous because the number one wearable computing early adopter crowd are all the sort of Fitbit, Jawbone, Misfit, wearing
body
media computing people that are measuring themselves to the nth degree, and their health insurance price has not changed. If you're walking 10,000 steps, surely you are a healthier person who just sits on a couch all day long. So why not? So I called a bunch of health insurance companies and asked them that question. And most of my chief information officer, chief risk officer friends and those companies said, we don't really know how to use it. Sorry, this whole big data thing, we only care about the finance side of it to invest the premiums. So I hung up the phone and said, by God, I'm going to start my own company. I'm going to start a health insurance company. And we started looking around for a product that a single vertical in healthcare that would be deeply underinsured, where we could make the biggest difference, where every incremental dollar was almost an infinite percent improvement, where adverse selection, which is a common problem for fledgling health insurance companies, is not a problem, where people don't try to scheme and get more money than they're deserving, really where health insurance serves the purpose of being an insurance company, or helping someone offset the cost of an expensive, unexpected treatment. The third one, I really wanted something that inspired love in its consumers, because the one thing that health insurers do not inspire is love. Just like banks, like the people don't normally say, I love my bank. My ATM card is, you know, not like, screw my bank because they're trying to screw me. That's roughly how you feel about your health insurer too. So in many ways, you can characterize HVF companies as trying to clean up the image of a bad industry. Like banking, you know, hopefully you've seen, if not read, Too Big to Fail. It's like a 1,000-page book about how terrible the banking system is in this country. With a firm, we're hoping to clean up some of that image. Glow is an attempt to do the same thing for the health insurance, which might be harder because those guys are really, they enjoy their reputation for a reason. But pretty randomly, I think it actually was me who asked the question, is infertility treatment an insurable health condition? And it is not, which is remarkable because there are 150,000 families every year in the US going through some form of infertility treatment. It's about a $5 billion market, and it's basically if for 10 months you're trying to start a family and you cannot, you become clinically infertile as a couple, and then you go through pretty excruciating set of tests, and this happens to you significantly later in life typically, unless you're a 15th year graduate student, you probably haven't dealt with this just yet. But once you're in your late 30s, it becomes really hard for a woman to conceive because just the natural aging processes. But it's not impossible. And the way to move the almost impossible, really, really hard to a lot easier is you have to predict the ovulation window really, really tightly. The fertility window for couples to try to have a baby narrows down with age pretty significantly, and the probability of conception drops off quite exponentially. So what we did is we built an app which runs on your smartphone. It's this beautifully designed piece of software that collects data from women and their partners about both their obvious fertility markers, like the ovulation tests, as well as body temperature, mood, sexual activity, all kinds of stuff, and tries to predict when would be the best window to try for a baby. And it uses big data to model fertility cycles and ovulation windows for women. And it was a bit of a pipe dream because none of us were doctors or OBGYNs or fertility specialists by training, except this guy, Mike, my co-founder and CEO for Glow. When I called him with this idea, he lives in Shanghai. He has a whole team around him in Shanghai that he's been working with for years. I called him up and said, I'm going to do a fertility company. I know it sounds crazy, but I think you might like it. He said, are you crazy? I love it. We had a terrible time conceiving, so I meant to start this company with you. And so it was kind of serendipity out of his initial tragedy. Now they have a beautiful kid, so they've succeeded, but they definitely had a very hard time. So we started Glow, and it's really working. It's this big data model that gathers hundreds of thousands of women's ovulation data, predicts ovulation windows very precisely, and we're now responsible for about 30,000 babies that were born for women, or not born yet, some of them are in the womb, but conceived to women that have self-identified as infertile. So we've basically knocked out quite a good number of dollars from the unnecessary infertility treatments, because these women are conceiving completely naturally without hormonal treatments, et cetera. The cool thing about it is that, more apropos the age of this group, at some point we realized that the not trying to conceive, the group that used Glow as a birth control device, was growing, outpacing growth of Glow itself 2-to-1. So we sort of said, oh, wait, this is pretty important. So we basically built an app for that group as well, which requires less data and doesn't care as much about predicting it super tightly, and instead focuses on making sure that you do not hit the ovulation window. We've since sort of expanded it into a pregnancy tracker app, and we'll probably do a couple other segments pretty soon. The goal being offsetting the cost of these unnecessary treatments, trying to predict a likely negative outcome and offsetting it with something that prevents it. So, in general, this is a 5-second rant on healthcare, and I'll stop there. But one of the things that this country has seen is an unprecedented rise in costs of healthcare. And the Affordable Care Act and all these different things, unfortunately, are not going to fix the problem. They're fundamentally about redistribution of costs. It's a bit like a waterbed. The amount of water inside the waterbed doesn't change. If you plop down and really press on one side, the water's going to pop out on the other. So forcing the costs to be spread across a certain demographic, young people will pay a little bit more, and that money is going to go to fund treatments for old people. And you know, fill in the two opposing groups. Less here, more here. The only way that I can think of, and I've asked a lot of smart people to help me think this one's through, healthcare will really come down in costs, is arbitrage of prevention instead of correction. Correction is really expensive. Once you got something that needs a surgical or just some sort of invasive treatment or even non-invasive treatment, it's a lot of money. If you could track the condition before and say, hey, you know what? You're monotonically gaining weight for 7 days in a row and you have pre-existing heart condition, you're developing an edema, this will result in cardiac congestive heart failure, essentially, with extremely high degree of certainty. Get off the scale, go to a doctor's office. That's a $500 trip for a blood thinner. If you don't get that alert, that's a $10,000 admission to ER, and you might be not really being admitted so much as written up as a corpse. So there's a lot of money to be saved by preventing bad things from happening than correcting them. So Glow and all the products that Glow works on is just an attempt to use data to prevent.
Right. There's an amazing spectrum of things you can apply the big data to. We've got a group of 20 to 27-year-olds here in the audience for the most part, and they're budding entrepreneurs. They love to follow in your footsteps. What advice can you give them? What do you wish you would have done at University of Illinois before you left that would have helped better prepare you for the journey that you're on?
Take a psychology class. So if you're a tech major, this is entirely personal experience, so take it for what it's worth. So I enjoyed every computer science class, and God knows I tried to take every computer science class offered at University of Illinois. I was a nerd's nerd. I spent lots of time doing computer science homework. I loved every moment of it. I never took a psychology class. Instead, I did computer music, which was just more computer science classes, basically. At some point, one of my startups blew up because I had a falling out with my co-founder. This was before anything noticeable. And I realized that I was terribly unprepared to start a company on my own. I always needed the business co-founder, the person who would tell me what the customer would want, how they would think about it, what would be the theory behind the business. And I said, well, I don't, at the time I was of course young and naive, and I basically said, well, I do not need any more co-founders. I'm done with this co-founder garbage. This person was not who I thought they were. I'm never gonna have another co-founder. I gotta learn to do everything myself. Which is another sort of footnote of an advice. Starting with someone, way easier than on your own. If you can help it, have a co-founder. Doing it entirely on your own is very, very lonely. And no one can hear you scream. So it's true. One of the most common refrains between sort of Peter and me in the PayPal days, we would run into each other's office. We had two separate offices on the opposing corners of our final building. Before then, we had no offices. We just had cubicles. But the last building that we had after we went public, it was a pretty nice office. And we had these two opposing offices pretty far apart. And every other day, one of us would run into the other guy's office, plop down on a couch, and be like, we're totally, like, we're done, like nothing. And the other guy would be like, ah, it's not that bad, right? Like, after half an hour of whining, you're like, all right, it's not that bad, you're right. But it was really hard when I thought of it first. And so having that person you can honestly tell that you're just terrified is way easier than staring yourself in a mirror and going like, can't even scream loudly because your employees will hear you and they'll lose confidence and they'll leave, and that's no good. So you kind of have to. So anyway, so co-founder, important, but doing it all myself, not needing a co-founder, was my theme of the day at the time. And I tried to figure out what it is that I didn't know. So I'd never taken a class in accounting, and there's another great story in there somewhere, but I'll spare you that one. The short version being the CFO at PayPal, two nights before we launched, said, by the way, we are doing double entry accounting, right? In the ledger that we built for the bank behind PayPal, it said, what's double entry accounting? He said, oh no. So the entirety of the PayPal system was built on a single entry accounting. 2 days before we launched. And we did rewrite it in 24 hours, but it was definitely a close call. And the way he found out is I left a note in one of the payments for myself, and he read it because it was a single entry. So he could see both notes. Accounting, you can pretty much pick it up pretty quickly, though. I took one night and I was all right. Debits, credits.
Psychology
is very, very interesting. It's the thing that most tech majors laugh off because it's such a soft science, like, oh, you know, gosh, how do you feel today? You know, really, you know, tell me more about your mood. That's my perception, anyway, in college about psychology. So I never taken a single class. When I started trying to figure out how to prepare myself for life without a co-founder, so said, well, I need to understand marketing, I need to understand finance, I need to understand advertising, all the things that I'd never thought about. And finance was a thin textbook, and I was done. It was very precise. There are a bunch of other things that I'd never learned, like structure of basic compensation plans and stock options and dealing with bankers and all that stuff. You can pick it up very quickly with a technical degree. It takes no time to learn it. Marketing and advertising, so like, why are these things true? I don't understand why people do this. And there's no explanation. It's just, well, you know, this happened. Most marketing books, most advertising books are essentially stories of a failed product of this kind or that kind. They ran this campaign and they thought it would work, but it didn't. The horror, you know, this brand failed. And then they renamed it Febreze and it worked. Like, why? And I was trying to dig into it and I finally realized that everyone who reads marketing and advertising books has taken a whole bunch of classes in psych. So I thought, all right, well, I need to go learn about psychology. And so I am, for the last 15 years, an avid consumer of papers and books on applied psychology. If you're building a product, you're ultimately trying to predict how users are going to react. So this notion of just think like a 19-year-old girl in the middle of America is a lot easier said than done. If you're building products, which is what Glow is, you know, I have to think, how do I destigmatize the notion of a period? How do I explain the concept of cervical mucus to someone who blushes just thinking about talking about fertility and reproductive health issues with her parents, with her friends? So it's not an easy thing to do, and yet it's a key unlocking a huge healthcare cost. So figuring that out is basically consumer psychology. So if I have one advice, if you're thinking of building a startup that faces consumers, applied psychology. If you're thinking about a startup building for business, organizational psychology. Even more interesting, how do people react to conflict and concepts in groups? They always look for cues. How do they sort of figure out who gets to speak first? Fascinating. And psychology, much to my amazement, is a very precise science. You can read papers that read more densely than a math paper because a lot of it is highly empirical, but it's quite precise. There's a lot of testing being done. There's lots of great books by the likes of Dan Ariely and Robert Cialdini, but there's lots of really good research that comes out of universities.
And we're lucky here at Carnegie Mellon. We have a major called Decision Sciences, and I call it the big data major. It's psychology, statistics, and economics. That's how people think, how they make decisions. And we also have great electives in organizational behavior in the business school too. It's one of the strengths of Carnegie Mellon. What we'd like to do now is open the floor to questions for Max. Would anybody like to start? And please speak up when you do. Yeah.
Go. How do you approach a business in like a heavily regulated area versus one that's not regulated? I mean, some of like the big opportunities like either healthcare or finance. How's that like different than consumer space?
So those are my favorite. I love highly regulated markets. Because basically a random, not particularly passionate about that area person will come close and look at it and say, oh my God, that's so hard to do. There's a Washington full of people trying to stop me from innovating. Forget it, I'll go build a video game. So competition is necessarily scarce. Big companies that are entrenched players say, I am completely safe. I paid off all the lobbyists a long time ago. We're fully regulated in my favor. It takes effort to figure out what the entry point is, but once you get in, you actually can outplay existing players by being smarter. I prefer games where being harder working and being more thoughtful about several moves ahead is an advantage versus just a land grab or a better marketing slogan or... Today, it's very important to have good design because there's so much choice in every imaginable part of software that if you have sort of a poor quality, indifferent attitude towards the user will not notice you. But it's not a sustainable advantage. Everyone around you eventually figures out that good design is important and it's kind of no longer a secret. Good design applied to a tightly regulated market where it's just really hard to get in is a great place to go. So I approach them with great amount of excitement and no trepidation whatsoever, but I've played in that particular pool before, so I know it's doable. The actual sort of actionable advice I would say, pick an area that you know you will have passion for in the long term. So if you just think healthcare is a big financial opportunity, that's great. Find a part of healthcare that speaks to you. Like if you have someone in your family that's been impacted by a certain disease or something that you've interacted with, or you know someone where you say, you know, this is important to me, I need to do something about this. Don't care how regulators, don't care how hard it's gonna be, you are in a prime position to this, and then just start digging. Research in highly regulated industries is super valuable, because one other really cool secret about highly regulated industries, payments in particular, but healthcare as well, lots of insiders, even especially the ones at the very top, don't actually understand how things work. The number of payment executives that I, so one of the greatest interview questions for senior executive talent that we were hiring at PayPal, say, all right, you've been in the credit card industry for 15 years. You know, yes, great. You know, which I ran a program at the, you know, Countrywide Bank, and okay, great. Can you please explain to me how the, so interchange, which is the fee that the credit card issuing bank, acquiring bank, and the network together charge, is about, call it 2.6% plus a fixed fee of between 20 and 35 cents. That's a standard charge and varies a little bit on both sides, but in 5 minutes or less, explain to me more or less exactly how does that money get distributed? Who takes first cut? Who gets the second cut? What are the percentages? The number of people in extremely senior positions would say, well, you know, the network, Visa collects their 2.5% and there's a fixed charge. Yeah, that's interchange. Like, you have no idea what you're talking about. The vast majority of the money goes to the issuing bank. The network takes the smallest cut possible. Just the knowledge of the extreme minutiae of how things really work and why and what are the historic reasons typically just blows up in your face with opportunity. You kind of go from like, really? For example, there is an 11 bips, basis points, in that typical anyway, in the interchange that I just quoted, that goes, and it actually really breaks down to like literally 1.5 to 2 bips to sometimes half a bip. So these are really, really small amounts, but it's a several trillion dollars worth of annual revolving credit, so it's a lot of money in aggregate. This goes to things like network fees. So back in the day when these were leased lines and someone had to pay for them, Visa subsidized a fair amount of traffic. So they would collect a little tariff for routing packets over the network. Of course, that's been completely eliminated as a cost because it all goes over the public internet. So that's just money being thrown into the fire to the tune of a couple hundred million dollars a year. So digging into those opportunities in a tightly regulated industry inevitably finds, initially you'll feel like, wait, am I the smartest guy in the street? Like all these people with 15 years of experience in this industry have no idea that money being set on fire every second here. And within a few weeks of research, you're like, yes, I am. I am the only one. And yeah. Like, great, a company to be.
It makes a good point. If you're going to be an entrepreneur, if you're not an expert in the market segment you're going, you need to do a deep, deep dive and become an expert because those opportunities can be exploited. And I think that also dovetails nicely with Peter Thiel's new book, Zero to One, saying, hey, don't go into crowded spaces. Find markets that are underserved. Maybe it's because regulation, maybe it's for another reason, because entrepreneurship is about creating monopoly and monopoly power early on. If you're doing the right thing, over time you will attract competition, but be the monopoly owner, right? So,
I'll try to stick to shorter answer. So let's tune it into a blitz round.
Yeah, right here. Hi Max, thanks for coming. My question is regarding mobile payments. Where do you see that industry going? Right now it looks like it's almost going to be a little bit platform dependent, but how would you, running a firm, try to steer in a direction where
that does not qualify for a short answer, unfortunately. I'll try to keep it very short. So there's several different kinds of mobile payments. There's the offline, I walk into a store and I use my phone to pay, and that is not a problem that needs solving. So this is your applied psychology in action. So think of, you're checking out at Whole Foods. You are a 37-year-old young mother with a screaming baby in one arm and a big cart in front of you. What is the easiest way of paying as the cashier is unloading your cart for you and loading it into a bag? Reaching for your credit card, swiping it is perfectly serviceable, especially if it's a debit card. You don't need to even sign anything. Just put in a PIN and move. Versus, what do you get to give up? You let go of the cart, or do you put the baby down? Or you need to get your phone. You need to type in your PIN. You need to wave it next to the NFC reader. That's a lot of steps. A card will do just fine. Seeing how the NFC is just the interface to the card, which is the interface to your money. So that's a level of indirection you don't need. A card is a perfectly good interface to your money and the checkout register in most circumstances. Now, once it goes into a fully touchless, you walk into a store, the NFC reader says, hey, that's you, your favorite drink is a soy latte. is being prepared, please tap here, you know, touch your phone if you want anything else, that starts becoming interesting. And even that, it's still a little bit nebulous in my mind. Mobile payments where your phone is a browser is going to happen because your phone is going to be your primary browser. There's tons of different interesting solutions. PayPal is obviously a player. All the sort of usual suspects are a player. I care less about payments because that's sort of the veneer on top of the underlying financial infrastructure, which is primarily credit in this case. I certainly care a lot about credit, given what we're doing with the firm. You know, if I have it my way, next couple of years, there'll be a few $1 trillion going through the Affirm lending network, and that'll be good. And by then, we'll figure out a way to make the offline payments useful too.
One last question, maybe the person in the back there, yeah.
So you recommended that as students, we should take psychology classes. So outside of classes, what are other resources you might recommend for learning about psychology? It's a very broad topic.
Sorry, what do I recommend for entrepreneurship?
What would you recommend as resources for learning about psychology?
Psychology. Read a book called Influence by Robert Cialdini. It's probably the classic of a pretty academic approach to this stuff. There is another book called, I think it's called Addictive, but don't quote me on it, by Jonah Berger. It's a kind of a modern retelling of similar topics, but it's more focused on things like viral marketing. Why do things go viral? I don't think it's called Addictive, I'm sorry. I'm blanking the name, but it's a one word adjective sounding thing. Jonah Berger only wrote one book, so you'll be able to find him. There's also a great book by Dan Ariely called Irrationally Predictable, which is, or Predictably Irrational, sorry. That's a researcher that's nearby. There's tons of Dan Ariely talks at TED, kind of various lectures that he gave. Very prolific speaker, very prolific writer. There's a lot of really good public resources.
If you want to go back to first principles, there's a book called How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie, founder of this university. Not. but that's a great book, and to understand how people decide in an organization and how to influence people to purchase your product.
There's some extraordinarily quaint sexist commentary in that book. So it's a great read, but he's sort of like, no matter what your tolerance for political incorrectness is, you will cringe. It's like, oh.
It was written in 1930, before we even knew what political correctness was.
No, it is incredibly sexist, but the psychology conclusions are useful, but sort of, I read it once in Russian and once in English. And when I was reading it in Russian, it didn't really offend me nearly as much as I read it as an adult in English. And I'm like, oh my God, they still publish this kind of stuff? Wow, this is awful. But it does contain a collection of really good insights. It is not by the founder of this university. But there's tons of really good books that you can read. And I would say the sort of the rabbit hole into this is Influence by Cialdini. If you search for it on Amazon, there's a huge list of books, sort of the classic, people who bought this or read this also read this. Read the reviews. Most of these books are worthless because they're just different takes on the same concept. Every once in a while, you'll find one that is 5-star, and that's typically pretty good. I think I pretty much read them all, and the rating on Amazon correlates really well to the quality of the book. There's a lot of really good modern research that's being done on psychology.
Max, it's been amazing. I really appreciate you coming to Carnegie Mellon and sharing your stories. It's an inspiration to all of our young entrepreneurs. We hope that, first of all, Affirm and Glow are going to hire some great entrepreneurs from our great university, but we'd love to have you back. So please come back. Everybody, please join me in thanking Max and your team.